remember that the army chiefs that were involved have already been investigated. A serving governor is caught in all of this, plus the ex-minister of Panikoro. So indeed, this throws a lot of revelations that we must investigate and get to the bottom of it.
Of course, Channels Television will like to say that the thoughts of those of our guests yesterday and in that particular report that you just watched, the thoughts and the statements are totally theirs and not of Channels Television, as some of the issues raised here are subject to further confirmation and investigation. But Mr. Akpadaye, tell me, with these kind of issues on the ground, allegations of 1 billion naira given to INEC officials, you heard that man say that there, does it not bring to mind some level of, he said in a larger part of the conversation that the former INEC chairman, Professor Atari Jega, was not part of that, but he made it clear yesterday on the program that some INEC officials were giving up to 1 billion naira.
He's thrown this allegation in the open. Luckily, he's alive to tell the story. I think, for me, that's the starting point of the investigation. He must be called in to tell the true side of the story and to name and shame those who were involved so we can get to the bottom of it. So date, all we hear is an INEC official. The INEC official obviously has a name. These are the things the investigation will unravel, and when it unravels them, then obviously these people must be brought to book. So going forward, you know that you can't just treat a nation with impunity and hope to get away with things like this. It's rather unfortunate, and this kind of revelation does really make you have a bite in your tummy as to the extent to which things have gone decadent. For me, it's important that we unravel this completely so that the future generations will learn totally and correctly from it what to do and what not to do when things like this occur.
Yeah, the Ekiti Gate matter brings to the fore the role of the military in elections. Of course, other security agencies, we hear about some of the things, like the man, Dr. Aluko, said that he was majorly in charge of the operations when they were planning, according to him. But again, one will be asking the question, what should the military be doing in election? Is it not sacrilegious for the military to even be part of our election? Some have said even the law categorically identifies what they should be doing and what they should not be doing when it comes to our electoral process.
The role of the military was clearly one of to provide security. If you remember before 2015 elections, the real argument of whether they should not be in the precinct and not be in the real fray in the theater of the elections. Strictly speaking, their role was to provide security and ensure that the parties and all involved in elections have some level of security and they present this time away violence and ballot box snatchings and what have you. But hearing allegations like this that they actually were perpetrating the process, to me, it is very worrisome. To me, it's something that is shameful if it doesn't is proven. And all corporates, in my view, should be brought to book. And so you name and shame them and have them pass through the relevant processes and are dealt according to the laws of the land.
And because one would be wondering, is the role of the police, isn't it? The role of the military is not even stated for election, actually, in our laws. As far as I've researched and found out, the military does not have a role in our election. All right, Mr. Akpadaye, I was asking you, I said in our laws, I've not found a place where the military has been given a role to play. Isn't it supposed to be the role of the police to take charge of security during elections?
Well, if you can hear me, Sharon, you know this, the APC at that time, in the previous elections, the elections before now, did make a lot of role, a lot of weather about whether the military had any role to play in election day proper. And eventually what happened was that the military was pushed back from the through a perimeter fence of the election. And what you had at that time was that they did patrol, but they were not really involved in the theater of elections. One of the challenges we've had over time, if I may, and if you must recall, one of the things we've had was that there were challenges, as it were, as to whether they had a full role to play in the military, in elections theater themselves. Because constitutionally, their role is one of protection of the territories, territorial integrity of Nigeria, and had nothing to do, as it were, with the election proper. For me, that was the legwork of the police, and the police should have dealt with that.
All right, now tell me, someone like a colleague of yours, Mr. Femi Falana, has said that it is criminal for any military officers to be deployed for the elections. What are your thoughts?
Well, that might be share of the divide. It's important you need to understand what they were deployed for. Were they deployed to be involved in the election process, or were they deployed, as it were, to deal with elections on the other side and to make people feel a sense of security? You need to know what which side of the divide is. For me, and this is a slight distinction, you can't really have them involved in the precinct or the area or the theater of the election proper. And what they did in the last dispensation in the 2015 elections was to have them mount patrols in the road for general security. So as it were, they were not involved in the election proper in the distribution and movement of ballots and what have you.
If you are to advise, for example, maybe the president or the INEC chairman today about security in elections, would you advise that the military should be used at all for any role during the election?
Ideally speaking, the military should have no role to play in an election. Ideally speaking, I mean, there's no brainer. The challenges we have and the peculiarities we have in the way the security operators run, and if you remember, under the Jega area, they did form a joint military task force which involved the military, the soldiers, the army, the navy, and the police. But really speaking, it's a civilian issue, and this issue, if you ask me, is one strictly within the purview of the police, and the police to actually be dealing with this. You can extend it to a point where you say you want the military to do have perimeter fence work and mount the roads because of the nature of our people and the fact that the violence might be perpetrated. But strictly speaking, stricto sensu, my direct answer to you is that our advice will raise our police force to a level where they can and should be able to do this by themselves alone.
All right. On this matter, Mr. Akweda, before I allow you to take a break on this Ekiti Gate matter, I'd like to ask you, there was a military report released where a few military officers have been indicted, and the report has been submitted to the military top officials and all of that. That is a very deep findings by the military, the inquiry board. But tell me, from that, what does it say about the system in Nigeria when people say that the system is faulty?
Difficult one. You see, you can't wish away what the general society is. The truth about it is that we got so low a point where the military ought to be a very disciplined force, and they always rose above the fray. But when you hear allegations like this, and actually reports coming from their own investigation, indicative as it were that the military was actually engaged in graft towards elections, then you really wonder how low we have gotten. I like to believe in the case of one Judas among the 12. I like to still believe that the military as an institution still have the best quality of men who can hold their own over test of time. But like the saying goes, one apple might spoil the rest. That's why it's very important, and very, very, very important I underscore the fact that whoever has been involved in this process must be brought to book, and so that the military can write the book and know the consequences for bad behavior.
All right, thank you so much, Mr. Akweda. Just all the thoughts. I will take a break on the issue of the Ekiti Gate. I will take a moment here on the program. When we return, we're going to switch gears and we move on to Anambra State, the intrigues, the controversies over the Supreme Court judgment and its outcome. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.